It would be possible, perhaps, to find a safe lodging somewhere, Ossipon spoke at last. But the truth is, my dear, I have not enough money to go and try with, only a few pence. We revolutionists are not rich. He had 15 shillings in his pocket, he added, and there's the journey before us, too. First thing in the morning at that. She did not move, made no sound, and Comrade Ossipon's heart sank a little. Apparently, she had no suggestion to offer. Suddenly, she clutched at her breast, as if she had felt a sharp pain there. "But I have," she gasped. "I have the money. I have enough money. Tom, let us go from here." "How much have you got?" he inquired, without stirring to her tug, for he was a cautious man. "I have the money, I tell you, all the money." "What do you mean by it?" "All the money there was in the bank, or what?" he asked incredulously, but ready not to be surprised at anything in the way of luck. "Yes, yes," she said nervously. "All there was. I've it all." "How on earth did you manage to get hold of it already?" he marveled. "He gave it to me," she murmured, suddenly subdued and trembling. Comrade Ossipon put down his rising surprise with a firm hand. "Why, then, we are saved," he uttered slowly. She leaned forward and sank against his breast. He welcomed her there. She had all the money. Her hat was in the way of very marked effusion, her veil, too. He was adequate in his manifestations, but no more. She received them without resistance and without abandonment, passively, as if only half sensible. She freed herself from his lax embraces without difficulty. "You will save me, Tom," she broke out, recoiling, but still keeping her hold on him by the two lapels of his damp coat. "Save me, hide me, don't let them have me. You must kill me first. I couldn't do it myself. I couldn't. Not even for what I am afraid of." She was confoundedly bizarre, he thought. She was beginning to inspire him with an indefinite uneasiness. He said surlily, for he was busy with important thoughts, "What the devil are you afraid of?" "Haven't you guessed what I was driving to do?" cried the woman, distracted by the vividness of her dreadful apprehensions, her head ringing with forceful words that kept the horror of her position before her mind. She had imagined her incoherence to be clearness itself. She had no conscience of how little she had audibly said, and the disjointed phrases completed only in her thought. She had felt the relief of a full confession. She gave a special meaning to every sentence spoken by Comrade Ossipon, whose knowledge did not in the least resemble her own. "Haven't you guessed what I was driven to do?" her voice fell. "You needn't be long in guessing, then, what I am afraid of," she continued in a bitter and somber murmur. "I won't have it. I won't. I won't. You must promise to kill me first." She shook the lapels of his coat. "It must never be." He assured her curtly that no promises on his part were necessary, but he took good care not to contradict her in set terms, because he had had much to do with excited women, and he was inclined in general to let his experience guide his conduct in preference to applying his sagacity to each special case. His sagacity, in this case, was busy in other directions. Women's words fell into water, but the shortcomings of timetables remained. The insular nature of Great Britain obtruded itself upon his notice in an odious form. "Might just as well be put under lock and key every night," he thought irritably, as nonplussed as though he had a wall to scale with a woman on his back. Suddenly, he slapped his forehead. He had, by dint of cudgeling, his brains just thought of the Southampton, St. Malo service. The boat left about midnight. There was a train at 10:30. He became cheery and ready to act. from Waterloo. Plenty of time. We are all right, after all. What's the matter now? This isn't the way, he protested. Mrs. Verloc, having hooked her arm into his, was trying to drag him into Brett Street again. I've forgotten to shut the shop door as I went out, she whispered, terribly agitated. The shop and all that was in it had ceased to interest Comrade Ossipon. He knew how to limit his desires. He was on the point of saying, what of that? Let it be. But he refrained. He disliked argument about trifles. He even mended his pace considerably on the thought that she might have left the money in the drawer. But his willingness lagged behind her feverish impatience. The shop seemed to be quite dark at first. The door stood ajar. Mrs. Verloc, leaning against the front, gasped out, nobody has been in. Look, the light in the parlor. Ossipon, stretching his head forward, saw a faint gleam in the darkness of the shop. There is, he said. I forgot it, Mrs. Verloc's voice came from behind her veil, faintly, and as he stood waiting for her to enter, she said louder, go in and put it out, or I'll go mad. He made no immediate objection to this proposal, so strangely motivated. Where's all that money? He asked. On me. Go, Tom. Quick. Put it out. Go in, she cried, seizing him by both shoulders from behind. Not prepared for a display of physical force, Comrade Ossipon stumbled far into the shop before her push. He was astonished at the strength of the woman and scandalized by her proceedings, but he did not retrace his steps in order to remonstrate with her severely in the street. He was beginning to be disagreeably impressed by her fantastic behavior. Moreover, this or never was the time to humor the woman. Comrade Ossipon avoided easily the end of the counter and approached calmly the glazed door of the parlor. The curtain over the panes being drawn back a little, he, by a very natural impulse, looked in, just as he made ready to turn the handle. He looked in without a thought, without intention, without curiosity of any sort. He looked in because he could not help looking in. He looked in and discovered Mr. Verloc reposing quietly on the sofa. A yell coming from the innermost depths of his chest died out unheard and transformed in a sort of greasy, sickly taste on his lips. At the same time, the mental personality of Comrade Ossipon executed a frantic leap backward, but his body, left thus without intellectual guidance, held on to the door handle with the unthinking force of an instinct. The robust anarchist did not even totter, and he stared, his face close to the glass, his eyes protruding out of his head. He would have given anything to get away, but his returning reason informed him that it would not do to let go the door handle. What was it? Madness, a nightmare, or a trap into which he had been decoyed with fiendish artfulness? Why? For what? He did not know. Without any sense of guilt in his breast, and the full peace of his conscience, as far as these people were concerned, the idea that he would be murdered for mysterious reasons by the couple Verloc passed not so much across his mind as across the pit of his stomach, and went out, leaving behind a trail of sickly faintness and indisposition. Comrade Ossipon did not feel very well in a very special way for a moment, a long moment, and he stared. Mr. Verloc lay very still, meanwhile, simulating sleep for reasons of his own, while that savage woman of his was guarding the door, invisible and silent in the dark and deserted street. Was all this some sort of terrifying arrangement invented by the police for his special benefit? His modesty shrank from that explanation. But the true sense of the scene he was beholding came to Ossipon through the contemplation of the hat. It seemed an extraordinary thing, an ominous object, a sign, black and rim upward. It lay on the floor before the couch, as if prepared to receive the contributions of pence from people who would come presently to behold Mr. Verloc in the fullness of his domestic ease, reposing on a sofa. From the hat, the eyes of the robust anarchist wandered to the displaced table, gazed at the broken dish for a time, received a kind of optical shock from observing a white gleam under the imperfectly closed eyelids of the man on the couch. Mr. Verloc did not seem much asleep now, as lying down with a bent head and looking insistently at his left breast. And when Conrad Ossipon had made out the handle of the knife, he turned away from the glazed door and retched violently. The crash of the street door flung to made his very soul leap in a panic. This house, with its harmless tenant, could still be made a trap of a terrible kind. Comrade Ossipon had no settled conception now of what was happening to him. Catching his thigh against the end of the counter, he spun round, staggered with a cry of pain, felt in the distracting clatter of the bell his arms pinned to his side by a convulsive hug, while the cold lips of a woman moved creepily on his very ear to form the words, "Policeman, he has seen me." He ceased to struggle, she never letting go. Her hands had locked themselves with an inseparable twist of fingers on his robust back. Whilst the footsteps approached, they breathed quickly, breast to breast, with hard, labored breaths, as if theirs had been the attitude of a deadly struggle, while, in fact, it was the attitude of deadly fear, and the time was long. The constable on the beat had in truth seen something of Mrs. Verloc, only coming from the lighted thoroughfare at the other end of Brett Street. She had been no more to him than a flutter in the darkness, and he was not even quite sure that there had been a flutter. He had no reason to hurry up. On coming abreast of the shop, he observed that it had been closed early. There was nothing very unusual in that. The men on duty had special instructions about that shop. What went on about there was not to be meddled with unless absolutely disorderly, but any observations made were to be reported. There were no observations to make, but from a sense of duty, and for the sake of the peace of his conscience, owing also to that doubtful flutter of the darkness, the constable crossed the road and tried the door. The spring latch, whose key was reposing forever off duty in the late Mr. Verloc's waistcoat pocket, held as well as usual, while the conscientious officer was shaking the handle. Ossipon felt the cold lips of the woman staring again creepily against his very ear. "If he comes in, kill me. Kill me, Tom." The constable moved away, flashing, as he passed, the light of his dark lantern, merely for form's sake, at the shop window. For a moment longer, the man and the woman inside stood motionless, panting, breast to breast. Then her fingers came unlocked, her arms fell by her side slowly. Ossipon leaned against the counter. The robust anarchist wanted support badly. This was awful. He was almost too disgusted for speech, yet he managed to utter a plaintive thought, showing at least that he realized his position. "Only a couple of minutes later, and you'd have made me blunder against the fellow poking about here with this damn dark lantern." The widow of Mr. Verloc, motionless in the middle of the shop, said insistently, "Go in and put out that light, Tom. It will drive me crazy." She saw vaguely his vehement gesture of refusal. Nothing in the world would have induced Ossipon to go into that parlor. He was not superstitious, but there was too much blood on the floor, a beastly pool of it all round the hat. He judged he had been already far too near the corpse for his peace of mind, for the safety of his neck, perhaps. At the meter, then, there, look, in that corner, the robust form of Comrade Ossipon, striding brusque and shadowy across the shop, squatted in a corner, obediently, but this obedience was without grace. He fumbled nervously, and suddenly, and the sound of a muttered curse, the light behind the glazed door flicked out to a gasping, hysterical sigh of a woman. Night, the inevitable reward of men's faithful labors on the earth, night had fallen on Mr. Verloc, the tried revolution, one of the old lot, the humble guardian of society, the invaluable secret agent Delta of Baron Stott Wartenheim's dispatches, a servant of law and order, faithful, trusted, accurate, admirable, with perhaps one single amiable weakness, the idealistic belief in being loved for himself. Ossipon groped his way back through the stuffy atmosphere, as black as ink now, to the counter. The voice of Mrs. Verloc, standing in the middle of the shop, vibrated after him in that blackness with a desperate protest. "I will not be hanged, Tom. I will not." She broke off. Ossipon, from the counter, issued a warning. "Don't shout like this." Then seemed to reflect profoundly. "You did this thing quite by yourself?" he inquired in a hollow voice, but with an appearance of masterful calmness, which filled Mrs. Verloc's heart with grateful confidence in his protecting strength. "Yes," she whispered, invisible. "I wouldn't have believed it possible," he muttered. "Nobody would." She heard him move about, and the snapping of a lock in the parlor door. Comrade Ossipon had turned the key on Mr. Verloc's repose, and this did not, from reverence for its eternal nature or any other obscurely sentimental consideration, but for the precise reason that he was not at all sure that there was not someone else hiding somewhere in the house. He did not believe the woman, or rather he was incapable by now of judging what could be true, possible, or even probable in this astounding universe. He was terrified out of all capacity for belief or disbelief in regard of this extraordinary affair, which began with police inspectors and embassies and would end goodness knows where, on the scaffold for someone. He was terrified at the thought that he could not prove the use he made of his time ever since 7 o'clock, for he had been skulking about Brett Street. He was terrified at this savage woman who had brought him in there, and would probably saddle him with complicity, at least if he were not careful. He was terrified at the rapidity with which he had been involved in such dangers, decoyed into it. It was 20 minutes since he had met her, not more. The voice of Mrs. Verloc rose subdued, pleading piteously, "Don't let them hang me, Tom. Take me out to the country. I'll work for you. I'll slave for you. I'll love you. I've no one in the world. Who would look at me if you don't?" She ceased for a moment. Then in the depths of the loneliness made round her by an insignificant thread of blood trickling off the handle of a knife, she found a dreadful inspiration to her, who had been the respectable girl of the Belgravian mansion, the loyal, respectable wife of Mr. Verloc. "I won't ask you to marry me," she breathed out in shamefaced accents. She moved a step forward in the darkness. He was terrified at her. He would not have been surprised if she had suddenly produced another knife destined for his breast. He certainly would have made no resistance. He had really not enough fortitude in him then to tell her to keep back, but he inquired in a cavernous, strange tone, "Was he asleep?" "No," she cried, and went on rapidly, "he wasn't, not he. He had been telling me that nothing could touch him. After taking the boy away from me under my very eyes to kill him, the loving, innocent, harmless lad, my own, I tell you, he was lying on the couch, quite easy, after killing the boy, my boy. I would have gone on the streets to get out of his sight, and he says to me like this, 'Come here,' after telling me I had helped to kill the boy. You hear, Tom? He says like this, 'Come here,' after taking my very heart out of me, along with the boy, to smash in the dirt." She ceased, then dreamily repeated, twice, "Blood and dirt." A great light broke upon Comrade Ossipon. It was that half-witted lad, then, who had perished in the park, and the fooling of everybody all around appeared more complete than ever. "Colossal!" he exclaimed scientifically, in the extremity of his astonishment. "The degenerate! By heavens!" "Come here," the voice of Mrs. Verloc rose again. "What did he think I was made of? Tell me, Tom, come here, me, like this. I had been looking at the knife, and I thought I would come. Then, if he wanted me so much, oh yes, I came, for the last time, with the knife." He was excessively terrified at her, the sister of the degenerate, a degenerate herself, of a murdering type, or else of the lying type. Comrade Ossipon might have been said to be terrified, scientifically, in addition to all other kinds of fear. It was an immeasurable and composite funk, which from its very excess gave him in the dark a false appearance of calm and thoughtful deliberation, for he moved and spoke with difficulty, being as if half frozen in his will and mind, and no one could see his ghastly face. He felt half dead. He leapt a foot high. Unexpectedly, Mrs. Verloc had desecrated the unbroken reserve decency of her home by a shrill and terrible shriek. "Help, Tom! Save me! I won't be hanged!" He rushed forward, groping for her mouth with a silencing hand, and the shriek died out. But in his rush he had knocked her over. He felt her now clinging round his legs, and his terror reached its culminating point, became a sort of intoxication, entertained delusions, acquired the characteristics of delirium tremens. He positively saw snakes move. He saw the woman twined round him like a snake, not to be shaken off. She was not deadly. She was death itself, the companion of life. Mrs. Verloc, as if relieved by the outburst, was very far from behaving noiselessly now. She was pitiful. "Tom, you can't throw me off now," she murmured from the floor. "Not unless you crush my head under your heel. I won't leave you." "Get up," said Ossipon. His face was so pale as to be quite visible in the profound black darkness of the shop, while Mrs. Verloc, veiled, had no face, almost no discernible form. The trembling of something small and white, a flower in her hat, marked her place, her movements. It rose in the blackness. She had got up from the floor, and Ossipon regretted not having run out at once into the street. But he perceived easily that it would not do. It would not do. She would run after him. She would pursue him, shrieking, till she sent every policeman within hearing in chase. And then goodness only knew what she would say of him. He was frightened that for a moment the insane notion of strangling her in the dark passed through his mind, and he became more frightened than ever. She had him. He saw himself living in abject terror in some obscure hamlet in Spain or Italy, till some fine morning they found him dead too, with a knife in his breast, like Mr. Verloc. He sighed deeply. He dared not move, and Mrs. Verloc waited in silence, the good pleasure of her savor, deriving comfort from his reflective silence. Suddenly he spoke in an almost natural voice. His reflections had come to an end. "Let's get out, or we'll lose the train." "Where are we going, Tom?" she asked timidly. Mrs. Verloc was no longer a free woman. "Let's get to Paris first, the best way we can. Go out first and see if the way's clear." She obeyed. Her voice came subdued through the cautiously opened door. "It's all right." Ossipon came out. Notwithstanding his endeavors to be gentle, the cracked bell clattered behind the door in the empty shop, as if trying in vain to warn the reposing Mr. Verloc of the final departure of his wife, accompanied by his friend. In the hansom they presently picked up, the robust anarchist became explanatory. He was still awfully pale, with eyes that seemed to have sunk a whole half inch into his tense face. But he seemed to have thought of everything with extraordinary method. "When we arrive," he discoursed. "When we arrive," he discoursed in a queer, monotonous tone, "you must go into the station ahead of me, as if we did not know each other. I will take the tickets and slip into your hands as I pass you. Then you will go into the first-class ladies' waiting room, and still there 10 minutes before the train starts. Then you will come out. I will be outside. You go in the first on the platform, as if you did not know me. There may be eyes watching there that know what's what. Alone, you are only a woman going off by a train. I am known. With me, you may be guessed at as Mrs. Verloc running away. Do you understand, my dear?" he added with an effort. "Yes," said Mrs. Verloc, sitting there against him in the hansom, all rigid with the dread of the gallows and the fear of death. "Yes, Tom," she added to herself, like an awful refrain. The drop given was 14 feet. Ossipon, not looking at her, and with a face like a fresh plaster cast of himself after a wasting illness, said, "By the by, I ought to have the money for the tickets now." Mrs. Verloc, undoing some hooks of her bodice, while she went on staring ahead beyond the splashboard, handed over to him the new pigskin pocketbook. He received it without a word, and seemed to plunge it deep somewhere into his very breast. Then he slapped his coat on the outside. All this was done without the exchange of a single glance. They were like two people looking out for the first sight of a desired goal. It was not till the hansom swung round a corner and towards the bridge that Ossipon opened his lips again. "Do you know how much money there is in that thing?" he asked, as if addressing slowly some hobgoblin sitting between the ears of the horse. "No," said Mrs. Verloc. "He gave it to me. I didn't count it. I thought nothing of it at the time." She moved her right hand a little. It was so expressive, that little movement of that right hand which had struck the deadly blow into a man's heart less than an hour before, that Ossipon could not repress a shudder. "I am cold. I got chilled through." Mrs. Verloc looked straight ahead at the perspective of her escape.